Hi, I'm Evans, a solution architect at Amazon Web Services. This video is going to be the first in a policy development series for Amazon Verified Permissions. I'm going to introduce how to use Amazon Verified Permissions along with your preferred identity provider to manage fine-grained authorization in the applications that you build. By the end of this series, you will learn how to structure policies on new applications. The goal of this primer series is to help you start writing policies with Amazon Verified Permissions. First, we will give you an introduction to Amazon Verified Permissions. We will take a look at an end-to-end architecture flow, discuss SIDA language, an open source language used to write permissions in Amazon Verified Permissions. We will then spend some time introducing a sample application, and we will start to create a permissions model for that application. Finally, we will summarize what we have learned and provide a link to the next video in the series where we will take this permissions model and create a schema. Amazon Verified Permissions provides fine-grained authorization as a service. It provides a policy administration point to build and test policies and a policy decision point to provide runtime authorization decisions to the applications that you build. Let's take a look at this end-to-end architecture flow to understand how Verified Permissions operates at runtime. In this diagram, we deploy an application using Amazon Cognito as the identity provider. A user logs in whether locally or via federation. Cognito generates a custom ID and access tokens. With these tokens, the user can request application endpoints. The browser sends the tokens to the API gateway. API gateway here serves as the policy enforcement point. It stops the request and executes a custom Lambda authorizer. The authorizer performs the isAuthorize call to verify permissions for a policy decision. Amazon Verified Permissions responds with an allow or deny decision. In this instance, the decision was allowed, so the request proceeds to the backend API. There are many variations to this architecture to meet different application requirements, such as integrating isAuthorize calls into the application itself or running an authorization container sidecar. Amazon Verified Permissions uses the SIDA language to manage fine-grained permissions in your custom applications. Next, let's talk about how policies are written in SIDA language. SIDA language is an open source policy language. It has an ergonomic syntax, which means it is human readable and easy to use. AWS did the heavy lifting to create a fast and safe evaluation engine. It supports automated reasoning, which means you can test with limited variables to determine if a policy does what it's supposed to do. This is what the SIDA policies look like. It consists of three parts: an effect, a scope, and an optional set of conditions. We will get more into this when we start writing SIDA policies in upcoming demos. To represent this data, SIDA provides four variables that are built into the language. These variables are principle, action, resource, and context. At least one of these variables can be seen in every line of the sample policy on the previous slide. While the content of these variables will differ between applications, the variables themselves exist in all SIDA policies. They represent the bedrock so to speak, upon which rules are expressed. Each variable encapsulates a collection of data containing a type, ID, and optional attributes. This can be visualized as four records, as in this example for a file sharing application. The principal entity contains information about the user who authenticated and is performing the action. Depending on the type of application, this could be a human actor, like a customer or employee, or it could be a software principal. The action contains information about what the principal is trying to accomplish. The resource entity contains information about the resource being acted upon. For example, if the action is view file, the resource is likely to be a particular file. The context, on the other hand, represents information that is unique to a particular access request. Next, let's introduce the custom application. So when we go into customer meetings to help customers write policies, one question that comes up is, well, how do we get started? And it all starts with the application. We need to know what that application model is. What are the actions? Who are the principals or the actors taking actions on the application? What are those components? For that, let's take a look at a sample application where we are going to identify two APIs with different access and start to pull this into a schema. We want to build a portal for a veterinary clinic. This portal allows pet owners to register their pets, create appointments with vets, and provide them with the ability to read their pets' medical records and test results. This portal is not just for pet owners. Vets are also able to log into this portal. Vets can read the details about the pets and also update the medical records and any test results that were conducted. As you must have realized, there are multiple levels of authorization needed in this case. But creating authorization becomes simpler when we follow a framework for designing and implementing authorization in our application. So let's take a look at the authorization framework. This is the Amazon Verified Permissions recommended framework to build authorization for applications. The authorization model is a narrative that describes the permissions within the application. It is typically built in conjunction with the business owner of the application. It involves four steps. Define the permissions model for the application. Define the schema and policies. Create the technical design. And build and test the application. In this video, we will be discussing the first step, define the permissions model. Let's decide on the permissions model for our vet application portal. Note that permissions model are defined in terms of principles, resources, and actions, just as we saw in the CIDA language format. They define the actions that each principal is allowed to perform on resources. Let's cover principles on this slide. Your application's user database can be maintained in any identity provider database store of your choice. For the Vet app, we use Amazon Cognito as the identity provider. In the Cognito user database, we maintain data about pet owners and vets. So, who are the principals? Well, the principals are individuals like Dylan, who is a pet owner, or Rashmi, who is a vet. We want to write policies about Dylan as a pet owner And as a pet owner, Dylan should be able to view records for only his pet. We also want to write policies for Rashmi as a vet. Now you might be wondering how Amazon Verified Permissions will get this user data. Identity data is typically packaged in the ID and access tokens that is provided at runtime. In a subsequent video, we will be able to write a CIDA policy that says a pet owner can view records in the database for a pet that they own. This is a simple policy statement that covers a large number of use cases. We will also be able to test these policies using the test bench included in Amazon Verified Permissions console. Next, let's cover the resources. In the vet application database, we maintain the pet details table and the pet medical records table. In the pet details table, we have data that originates from the owner, such as the pet name and how a pet is linked to an owner. In the pet medical records table, we have data that originates from the clinic, such as test results. Just looking at those tables, you start to see some authorization relationships. For example, a pet owner will want to read their pet's medical test results, and they may also need right access to this database to update their email address, for instance. But at the same time, we don't want pet owners to change test results. We want to provide fine-grained authorization to this data. So, what are the resources in this scenario? Well, the resources are the pet medical records and the pet details. On the previous slides, we were introduced to the principles and resources. Actions define what a principal is allowed to do on the resources. We talked about access to specific roles or fields in a database, but practically, this access is enabled via APIs that provide access to the data. Here, we can define the different actions that are available on the data. So what are the actions our users can perform when they log into the app? Well, when a user logs into the vet app, if they belong to the pet owner group, they can either register a pet or read their pet medical records. If they belong to the vet group, they can read or update pet medical records. In this video, we introduce the vet application. We define the actions that each principal is allowed to perform on our resources. In the next videos, we will learn how to define the schema and how to write policies. To learn more about Amazon Verified Permissions and schema, please scan the QR code on the screen. Thank you.